Alright guys, it's Chris from Cartridge Blast Gamers. I'm Chris, this is Rob.
Yo.
And we're playing Dominions 4, Thrones of Ascension. And this is a part 2 of probably a 2 or 3 part series. We'll see how it goes.
No more than 3, I think.
And
maybe even just 2.
Yeah, we're basically kind of running through Dominions 4 and trying to get stuff together and showing you how it's done. I myself am learning as well, because Rob here is the resident expert at Dominions 4, although he would never claim to be an expert at anything. I'm just giving him props.
Lies and slander.
But I am fascinated by this game and how in-depth it is. So as you guys come on, please like and subscribe as you see fit, and we'll get the tutorial underway.
All right. So, for anybody who missed part one, we are in the midst of a one versus one game against the AI. We are playing Fomoria under its god, Stony McStoneface, the monolith, and they are playing Ulm, whose god is some name I forget, the Archmage. Now, as you can see, the battle lines have more or less been drawn up on this scenario. When last we left our intrepid race of evil cursed storm giants, we had just finished researching a couple of key spells, the first of which being Thunderstrike, which is going to be probably our primary weapon for most of this game, and the second of which being aim, because I hate missing. Now, when last we left, we had been planning to assault this throne province of Lilithor before we mounted an all-out assault on the hated Ulmish. Now, you can see they have a couple of fairly large armies on our borders, so we really don't want to take too much time capping this throne. This one is just an absolutely ridiculous number of warriors and infantry guys. This one looks like it's more... It has a sizable auxiliary of clockwork soldiers and ogres, which are some of the units you can summon using summon spells. We do not have any of those yet, so we will just be using our standard spearmen. Oh, wow, that guy's hurt pretty bad. Let's pick somebody else. There we go. So, the last turn we had just finished researching the spell Thunderstrike, and now the time has come to put all these air gems we have been carefully saving up to good use. Ordinarily, Thunderstrike requires a wizard with 3 levels in the air path in order to cast. However, one of the simpler uses for gems is that you can have a unit use a gem to cast a spell as though he were one path higher than he actually is. There are a couple other limitations on it, but for spells like Thunderstrike, they don't really matter too much. So what we are going to do is we are going to award 6 air gems to each of the druids we're sending into this combat, where they're probably only going to use 3 of them in any one particular fight. And with any luck, this should be ludicrous amounts of overkill. We love overkill. To refresh the memories of anyone who has not checked in a while, this throne is guarded by a number of pretty much bog-standard... indie troops, heavy infantries, whose aren't too huge a problem except for the armor that they wear, which fortunately our thunderbolts will completely ignore, and horse tribe cavalry, whose main claim to fame is that they're really crappy troops on horses who have bows. The other issue is that they have a bunch of phantasmal warriors who are ethereal and can only be easily damaged by magic. If you're not using a magic weapon against them, something like 3 out of every 4 hits will just instantly miss. And they have a sorceress with them, who is probably going to be blasting us with some spells. Fortunately, we're bringing, I guess it looks like, 7 wizards to the party. So, we should have them considerably outnumbered on almost every conceivable flank, which is the way we like it. We've got our prophet present. I'm actually going to swap in for him. Rather than his first smite, he's going to use this spell, Divine Blessing. Now, if you have... what Blessing does is it does a bunch of different things depending on how you built your god. Our god is not particularly amazing, but if I remember correctly, we gave him some magic that will help to reinvigorate our troops, which will help them get more spells out faster. So we're going to be trying to use Divine Blessing, which will give our god's bless effect to all of our sacred units. The only sacred units we're using are these druids, but that's okay. That's really the important guys we want to bless. So we now have all of these dudes set up. I guess we might as well take this guy with the Heartfinder sword. I mean, you don't bring something like that to the party and then not use it. So let's set him to... Is there anything useful he can cast? Not really. We're just going to have him... Actually, we're going to have him hold 2 rounds and attack closest. We want to set basically all of our javelin guys to throw javelins and then hold off. Our crummy unit of slingers here to just shoot slings and stay away from everyone. And now we get to the fun part. Our druids. Now, it's a little more complicated to script mages because you can script the first 5 rounds of their spell casting, which is amazing. So, our first step is we're going to use aim because we don't want to be shooting thunderbolts that are going to miss. And the second thing we are going to do is start throwing out thunderstrikes. Now you'll notice it's grayed out. That's because we don't have 3 paths in air magic, but we're going to click it anyway, and you'll see that it goes in anyway because we have the gems to do it. Now, the thing to note about this is that all spellcasting in Dominions works on a fatigue system. Every spell costs a certain amount of fatigue. If you are a higher level than it takes to cast the spell, you can negate some of that fatigue, but since we are basically just squeaking in there, we're going to end up paying the full cost. Every unit has 100 points of fatigue they can take before they fall asleep. So, you can see Thunderstrike costs 50 of them. So this is going to be a very expensive spell for us. What is probably going to happen is aim is a very cheap spell, so that'll go off. We'll get, you know, maybe 2 or 3 fatigue out of that because it's, you can see it only takes 1 air. So if you have a spell that's level 1 and you have a level 2 wizard cast it, he only takes half the fatigue. So that's only going to cost us 2 or 3, completely negligible under the circumstances. Our first Thunderstrike's going to hit us with another 50. That'll bring us up to 52. Our second one will bring us up to 102, so then our unit's going to fall asleep. He'll probably sleep through this 4th round, and every turn he sleeps, he's going to regain 5 fatigue. He's going to regain 5 fatigue points, basically, which will let him get off 1 more Thunderstrike in round 5. So this is going to be our script. He probably won't wake up to cast again after his 3rd Thunderstrike, but just in case, we're going to leave that scripted so he can at least spam some lightning or something. And yeah, alright. So this is the order for our druids. This option here, conservative magic gem usage, we're going to click that because we have gems on this guy and we don't want him just wasting them willy-nilly. He's going to be spending probably 3 of them per fight, and that's all we want him to spend. This way, we can be sure he'll last for a good 2 fights before he needs to resupply at one of our labs. Useful trick as far as the orders screen goes. If you hold down control and press a number 1 through 10, you can save the order that your mouse is over into a kind of an invisible clipboard, and then you can press that number, I'm using 2, to paste it on all the other units you want to do that thing.
That saves so much time.
Amazing. Oh god, it saves so much time.
That's amazing.
Otherwise we'd be here for days. Oh, hello Owlbear Games. Good to have you on the stream. So if you're just tuning in, we are just getting ready on, I believe it's turn 13, to really get this game underway with some fireworks. Alright. All our commanders are useless, so they're just gonna hang out behind everybody. Honestly, Oops. Wrong thing. I kind of want them to hang out back here, just because at least they'll be a little safer there.
And so you can individually maneuver all your commanders to the back of the field?
Yep. In fact, I'm about to do that with the druids, too, because the druids are really the core of this army. They're the most important characters we have, because they do probably about 90% of our damage.
And what's the range on a druid?
Well, it depends on the spell he's casting. The technical range on Thunderstrike is 100 squares. So it hits basically the entire field. It can hit anywhere on the field.
All right, so then, yeah, putting him up front makes no sense.
The other catch, though, as far as range goes, is you have to worry about precision. And this is why we took the time to detour into that aim spell.
Right.
Thunderstrike has a precision of 2, which means that its precision gets added to the unit's precision to figure out how much scatter you're going to have from your spells.
Got it.
So when casting Thunderstrike, Cathwar here is going to have a precision of 11, which means that every 11 squares, basically, there's a chance for him to scatter one additional square.
Okay.
So, up till 11 squares, he's going to be right on target every time.
Nice.
You know, up to 22 squares, he'll have like a 1 square radius that he'll be hitting and so on.
Okay.
What the aim spell does, and does very cheaply, which is why I love it so much, is it increases his precision by, I believe, 5 points. Yeah, 5 points. So, if we are having a good day, what will happen is all of the druids will improve their own aim and basically just start shooting super accurate thunder strikes that will not miss anything as far out as about 16 squares. How multiplayer works in this game. Okay. The way multiplayer works in this game, Owlbear, is basically there's two basic formats for multiplayer. There's Blitz and Play by Email. If you're playing Blitz, everybody needs to be online playing at the same time, which is not as bad as it seems because you have simultaneous turns. If you are playing Play by Email, then usually what will happen is everybody will set a certain time limit for the turns. Like, you know, the first 6 turns of the game will be, maybe 24 hours apart, and you'll increase the time based on that depending on how much you need. So you'll play, you know, maybe a turn every day or so. I think most of the games that you'll see played on Steam are usually Blitz, but there are some other services that exist, like Llama Server is the big one that facilitates play by email. So it kind of depends on the community which one's more popular. Let's see. So we have, what else do we need to do here? Do we have any more druids to move? I can't remember. Yes, we do. All right. So the other trick to positioning here is that our druids, you can see they have a size of 4. An ordinary human has a size of 2. Oh, no problem, Owlbear. And you can fit up to 6 points worth of size in a single square. So these guys, I basically can't put 2 giants in the same square, but I can do a giant and a human. So I'm just kind of trying to get the giants positioned properly. You're not coming to the fight. you. I actually probably want you on the front lines. My prophet. I guess I actually want my prophet a little closer than that. Okay, that's fine. All right, so now we're going to worry about the troops. Now, the thing with the troops is that we really want them to be... I want to give the enemy plenty of time to close. Because the more time that he takes to come to me, the more time I have to rain lightning on his sorry ass. So, what we're going to do is we're going to basically keep our troops fairly close behind. But I also am going to try not to keep my slingers too close. Actually, no. You know what I'm going to do with these slingers? I'm going to place them in with the druids. So that way the aims... You can see that the aim spell that the druids are scripted to cast has an area effect of 1. Now, that doesn't mean one person. That means one square. So if I have a druid and a slinger standing in the same square, it'll hit both of them.
Oh, there you go. That makes so your slingers will be more accurate by proxy?
Yep, exactly.
Good.
The other reason I'm doing that is because I really don't want the druids accidentally casting aim on the slingers and not themselves. I don't care if the slingstones miss. Slingstones are terrible.
I was going to say, slingers are terrible units anyway.
Yes, they are.
They were like your fodder unit from the beginning of the game.
Not fodder exactly, because they don't hold up very well if stuff actually starts hitting them, but they're crappy units. Alright, so this is my main group of Fearbulg. I want to keep them fairly close. Again, I want to keep them at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so I actually probably need to keep them up here somewhere in the middle, because that way they'll be out of range of aim. Which you can see only allows... Oh, it's 5 plus. Plus means that for every extra level you have in that path, it gets increased by 1. So we're going to make sure that there's at least 6 squares of space between them and the druids, just so that, you know, they don't accidentally get buffed when I don't want them to be. We're going to put these guys over on that flank. We're going to put these guys over on that flank. We've got these guys who are going to be kind of my catchers in case anything gets passed. All right. You could, if you have a really big battle coming up, you can spend hours and hours and hours scripting this crap, but we're kind of doing a quick and easy one here. All right. You can see...
Call it down and dirty. As a down and dirty version.
Yep. Exactly. Now, I'm going to put this guy down here, and rather than attack closest, I think what I actually want him to do is... I might have him hold a couple of turns and then try and go for any enemy commanders at the rear. So maybe what I'll actually do is this. I'll kind of put my forces up a little bit. My line of catchers can go down a little bit. So this way what will happen is hopefully the enemy troops will see these three groups here. Say, oh, those are your, you know, those are my closest troops. I better send somebody to go deal with that. And then they will, with any luck, target these guys, leaving the path clear for my champion to run straight to the back and murder the shit out of that wizard. We'll see if it actually works. It's attack rear strategies are really, really kind of less reliable than you would like them to be. But I figure, what the heck? He's got a shield that murders everything that attacks him. He's got a sword that kills people in one hit. I'm not too worried about him dying.
Yeah, he's like the commando of the group right there.
He totally is.
He's got cheat codes.
Hacks! Alright, I don't have to worry about blessing anybody because my prophet's on that, and I think we're good to go.
Oh, man.
So we're basically just going to take that whole squad of people.
It's freaking on.
And march them in here. Let's... make sure my Numidian commander here with the Heartfinder sword can sneak, so I have to hold down control when I click to make sure that he's moving and not sneaking. Now, I could move this guy actually into that fight too and have him participate. I might actually do that. The nice thing about him is this is a Fomorian king. As I mentioned last week, these are the big badasses of this faction. And you can see that he is a level 3 air mage, which means he doesn't have to do all that crap with gems to Thunderstrike. He can just do it all on his own. This is probably not the most useful thing you could be having a Fomorian king doing in the game, but it's the most useful thing I could have him doing with the spells that I currently know.
Now, could you have hit the number 2 on him to save your time to do all that stuff and things you just did?
I could have, but I wanted to see if there was anything. I wanted to just double check this list to see if there was anything else more useful I wanted him to do.
Oh, I see.
I could be throwing out, you know, he also is a, in addition to being an air mage, he is a, I think, a level 3 death mage, which is awesome. So if I really wanted to, I could be having him throw, like, this Bolt of Unlife or Shadow Bolt spells. Actually, maybe I'll do Shadow Bolt and... We'll stick with the Thunder Spike. No sense complicating things.
All right. And where do you want him to stand in the battlefield?
Way in the back.
I was gonna say,
way in the back.
Put the guy right in the middle, everyone's like, oh my god.
I really, really don't want this guy getting the crap kicked out of him, so I'm going to put him somewhere safe.
He's pretty expensive.
He is almost as expensive as a fortress, is how expensive he is.
Sure.
All right.
Now, those areas there that you're clicking next to, that's a fairly sizable army. Now, are we considering that forfeit until we beat the people over here?
Well, these guys actually can't attack us this turn. You can see that these two lines that lead to these provinces are broken.
Mm-hmm.
This is because this province has no temperature scales at the moment.
Got it.
If both provinces on either side of an orange line have heat scales, it means it's a mountain pass and the mountain pass is open.
Got it.
So, we don't have... There's no heat scales anywhere here, so this pass is closed. They can't go there. And this connection here goes over a river. That's what this blue line means. And you can see that this is broken, which means that the river's not frozen.
Oh, all right.
If there's cold scales on both sides of the river will freeze over, and then they'd be able to cross. But as it is, the only place they can go from here is back to Llama. And we don't really give a shit if they do that.
Well, that's good to know. I wasn't sure if you were putting yourself open in the flank, but it looks like you got that figured out.
Yep.
Which means that bridge is the choke point.
Pretty much. It will be the choke point until our respective dominions hit there. Because I know my dominion's neutral, so maybe we can keep that bridge to be our choke point. But his dominion, I'm pretty sure, is going to be cold. Let me see. I can't actually tell. Yeah, you can see his three black candles over in Epernia have produced one cold scale. So if his dominion spreads onto my side of the river, we might have to worry about the river freezing over.
Got it. Okay. Good to know.
That said, I'm not too worried about that. He's, as far as I can tell, he's only got one temple.
You're going to let him sneak in?
We're going to have this dude sneak into Bitane here just for extra vision. We're going to have this dude here sneak back into Mir just because I don't like to leave him in the capital too long. Capitals tend to be patrolled pretty heavily in case there's a, just because there's usually lots of troops there with nothing to do.
Got it.
But under the circumstances, I think we'll be all right. I'm going to move these guys back to Jelania Gora. I could move them into Rotmarsh. I actually am going to move them into Rotmarsh. The reason for that is that these guys were searching for magic sites. Now, magic sites have a higher rate of occurrence in fancy terrain types, such as the swamp and the border mountains in Rotmarsh. Jelania Gora has mountains, but swamps, I think in particular, tend to have a lot of death sites, and Eren here is searching for death sites, so who knows, maybe we'll get lucky.
Okay.
All right. Our research is continuing. Our current research goal is this storm spell, which once we have it, will make our thunder striking much, much, much cheaper in terms of magic gems.
Sure.
For reasons I will get into in a minute. So we're going to keep researching pretty much whole hog in evocations. Our research has slowed down considerably because we just took 7 of our mages out of the labs to go murder dudes, but that's all right. We have druids recruiting here, Nemedian warriors, which is awesome. Oh, what happened here? Let's cut down on the medians a little bit just so we can have more druids coming out. We can never have too many druids. That's like a rule of life. All right. And someone yesterday asked also, you can see the charts for today, but somebody asked also why we weren't going for a strategy that let us improve our research first. And the reason for that is that strategy costs air gems, which, as you can see, we are currently using to get tons and tons and tons of murder wizards out much earlier than we would normally be able to. So, while, yes, in a longer game, it would probably be better to have the research points, under the circumstances, this allows us to get our crazy Thunderstrike bullshit ready before the other player can build up a countermeasure. So with that said, let's see if we can have a glorious battle. Alright, the only interesting thing that happened this turn. Beautiful.
Wow.
Let's have a look at this because I've been waiting to see this.
Dun, 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 all right. Dun.
I'm going to pause this right off the bat. You can see...
Oh, set up the grids and the viewing.
Oh, yeah, good idea. That'll make things a little easier to track.
Right.
So any unit that's in a white square is one of theirs. Any unit that's in a purple square is one of ours. I think I reviewed this last stream, but just in case people didn't get it, the team-colored squares and show grid are the options I just set up, and we'll put on a very detailed battle log just because I like it. Okay. So Juna cast Personal Luck. Juna is... It looks like their side has two wizards. Juna the Sorceress is one of them. Holy crap, she has a ton of gems. She is a level 2 Air Mage, level 2 Astral Mage, level 3 Death Mage. This is a very, very powerful wizard. Fortunately, it's a very, very powerful wizard who only has 10 hit points and doesn't wear any armor. So pretty much, if anything gets to Juna, Juna will die. But in the meantime, she is going to cause me all kinds of problems. And this is Norvin, who is a level 1 Fire, level 1 Earth, level 2 Astral. I don't really anticipate too many problems with her, although she could be throwing like little magma bolts or casting some of the nastier astral spells at me. But I'm not really anticipating as big a problem with her as with this. This is ridiculous.
Yeah, she's
and
insane.
this is crazy. Yeah, this lady only has a couple of astral gems.
She's the apprentice.
Yep.
All right.
We have our opposition are these horse tribe cavalry guys. Like I said, they have lances, which are pretty nasty weapons. They inflict a ton of damage on the first hit in each battle, but afterwards they drop back down to a normal attack, which in this case will do like 13. And they have short bows, which are the standard issue range weapon for early age. But in this case, they're just kind of annoying because almost all my guys have shields. We also have heavy infantry, who are big, slow, and dumb. They have swords and shields and not much else. With any luck, these guys will be mostly gone by the time they reach me from being raked with lightning. And these jerks are the Phantasmal Warriors. These guys are not actually real warriors. They are illusions, as you can see by the fact that they have one hit point. They are magic beings, which means they can only be commanded by a wizard. They are lifeless, because they're not real people. They don't, they have all kinds of crazy crap going for them. But the big important one is that they're ethereal. Ethereal units, basically any time you hit one with a non-magical weapon, it has a 3/4 chance to nullify the attack completely.
Quick question.
Yeah?
If you kill the wizard,
yeah,
do those go away?
No.
Darn.
If you kill all the wizards on the field, I believe mindless units all die, or I believe magic being units will usually all die.
Okay.
They might also have to be mindless for that. But if I kill both these wizards, these guys will probably all die. But I expect I'll have to kill these guys before I get to the wizards.
Miserable.
Yep, it's fine. And I know it was fine because I saw the battle report before I loaded this up. So you can see here is Devlin, our prophet. He has tons of hit points because he's a prophet and he's awesome and he has a heroic ability that gives him tons of hit points.
Super Jesus.
Pretty much. He, yeah, he's going to be amazing. We have our slingers back here. I guess it didn't really put them where I wanted them to be, but that's all right. We have our
commanders and
our druids back here. We have our Fomorian king here and our massive hordes of dudes. So let's see how this goes.
Send in the dudes.
Okay, so both of their wizards cast Personal Luck, which is a spell that basically makes it so that the first anytime they are hit by an attack that would have killed them, it has a 75% chance of being negated.
Nice.
It doesn't protect them against anything that won't kill them, but it's going to make them a pain in the rear end to kill once we get there. It shouldn't be too bad still. So you can see, because I'm using the detailed breakdown, it's pretty one-sided. I like fights that are one-sided. The whole point of bringing out the thunder was to make this as one-sided as possible. Mostly because I need to preserve these guys for a confrontation with Ulm, which is going to be a lot less one-sided because I think he outnumbers me about 2-1. So you can see that it shows you what all the damage rolls were and how the calculations work, which is nice. So anybody who's trying to learn how the game works goes, that's how the game goes. That's a great way to do it. You can see our prophet just killed one of the illusionary guys with a smite. He's this square here is missing one. Our druids are all taking aim. Okay, now you can see that I think Juna just cast Raise Dead, which, you know, she can do as a necromancer. Raise Dead brings these soulless warrior guys out into the fight. Yeah, that's what I was talking about before. So, you know, that particular spell I think only summons one, but there's others that summon tons and tons and tons of them. I don't think it's going to be a huge issue because lightning. So, all right. So you can see their cavalry are shooting me. They're inflicting a few hits here and there among the troops. You can see those red numbers over their head or how much damage everybody's sustained. Oh, there we go. Bringing down the lightning. This is why Thunderstrike is amazing.
Wow, look at that. It totally, like...
You can see the Phantasmal Warriors are taking a fair bit of javelin fire. Which is okay. I mean, that's pretty much what they're for. What the heck is that underneath them? Oh, I think it's just a graphics glitch or something?
That's when...
Yeah, it looks like it's just a piece of the terrain peeking through. Okay. So you can see my Nemedians are... Or my Fearbold, rather, are fighting the warriors. We got another wave of lightning coming through. Sadly, none of them hit the two wizards, which would be a pretty much a best-case scenario here. You'll notice pretty much anything that touches the Phantasmal Warriors kills them. It's just touching them that's the hard part. They're basically just throwing really low-level spells at me, which is good. I guess they don't have a lot of credit for research. Oh, you can see the archers have routed because the lightning basically tore the hell out of them. We are now hitting... Oh, holy crow. She summoned a lot of undead here. Which it looks like are absorbing most of the lightning. That's unfortunate, but, you know, whatever. It looks like we've pretty much got this in the bag anyway. You will notice that some of my units are taking friendly fire from javelins. That's the other reason why I like to cast that aim spell before I start throwing lightning around. Okay, and you can see my wizards have gone off script because now they're casting shit like air shield and blessing that's doing them absolutely no good. But that's okay. Pretty much everything of import has retreated at this point. The only thing that hasn't are the skeletons because they're too dumb. They actually can't retreat. See how their morale is 50 here?
Is that maxed out?
That's... If it's 30 or higher, there's literally zero chance of retreating. It's just like a special case that makes you never flee. This guy's actually going to disintegrate in a second because there's no more necromancers on the field. Oh, he actually did. I wonder why that is. Okay. Either way, you know, that was exactly the stomp I was hoping for. So, we're going to go in here and try and feed some of these troops to other commanders for the very good reason that my champion is, or my Fearbold champion needs to spend a turn claiming this throne. Now, this throne is the Throne of Law. Basically, what it does is it counts, spreads Dominion 1 means it counts as a temple. In terms of spreading my dominion around. Which is good, because it means I'll have 3 to Alms 1, so my dominion should push further than his. It also makes my dominion get order scales, which are these doves here. Order scales are good, because basically every order scale you get is plus 5 income. Which is really hard to argue with. It's probably the second best gold scale in the game, so we really want that. So we're going to have him claim the Throne of Ascension. You can only claim the throne if you are a level 3 priest, or if you are using your pretender. Our pretender can't actually leave the capital, so it's pretty much just down to this guy. Now, we have to get these guys back to the front line, because the next thing they're going to be doing is murdering a bunch of All Mites. So we're going to move them back here. We're going to add him to the group. Oh, hey. They somehow spent all their gems. Note to self, maybe I shouldn't give them so many. All right. It's honestly, I love to watch people play this game too. I confess I usually prefer text to video. Oh, see his, there's cold spreading into this province from somewhere. I'm not sure why, but so you can see that this line is clear here.
I knew it.
So, maybe we need to bail on Rotmarsh. That just looks like a bad, bad place to be. I was debating buying some province defense here, but, I mean, really, he's got at least 90 troops here. There is not a damn thing I'm going to be able to do against 90 troops with any amount I can buy for 91 gold. So, in the words of the prophets, screw it. Oh man, the entire river froze over. That's not good. All right, that's fine. That's fine. We can deal with that. Let's see. Okay, we didn't have any other messages that turn. So we have some troops that we can start funneling out to the front line, which I think we're going to do because this is starting to look a little hairy. Most units actually have a... See how his movement is divided into two things, 2 and 10? 10 is how many units, how many squares on the battlefield he can move a turn. 2 is how many provinces on the map. It's a very theoretical number, though, because there are tons and tons of different terrain types that slow you down. So, like, forests, if you're moving through a forest, forget your 2, you're only moving one province. If you're moving through the mountains, forget it, you're only moving one province. But in this case, he can go from Fomoria to Ragdon to Lilithor without going through any weird terrain. So he's going to actually be able to move that far. Okay, our scout here has not seen anything particularly interesting. I'm going to move him. I'm basically going to keep waffling him between Mir and Ulm, just so that I can keep an eye on these provinces and kind of have my chance of getting caught. I see he's got a fortress here at Pulmania, so I'm going to move Tigernan down there to snoop on it a little bit. I imagine he's also planning on building one here in Ivanmore, just because it's a great idea to build forts on your thrones to make them harder to capture. We are not going to do that because we're fighting the computer, and he probably won't get this far into my territory. If he does, we're in very serious trouble, so we're not going to bother. Alright, you can see, province-wise, we're all tied up now. We both control basically our entire side of the map. Fort-wise, we're tied up now, because he just built that fort last turn. Income-wise, it's close. I'm a little bit ahead of him now, but not by much. Gem income, I've had guys sight-searching. It looks like he only just started. He's still ahead of me on research, but not by as much as he was. Wow, he must actually have a really powerful dominion on his wizard or on his wizard guy. That's really weird. Usually it doesn't spread that fast for an archmage type pretender. And obviously his army's ridiculous because we have the computer set on cheat mode. All right. So,
guess we're going to have to knock him down a peg.
Well, once they get back to Utenshire, I'm going to load them back up on lightning, maybe add these guys to the add this guy to the party. All right. Two more turns until we have storm. That'll be a good day. Actually, if it's going to be two more turns until we have storm, it depends if he attacks me next turn. If he doesn't attack me next turn, oh man, this is going to be sweet. He actually didn't. That's kind of shocking. I would have attacked me last turn. The throne of law has been claimed by a righteous pretender. Justice and order permeates throughout the spheres. Worldwide, order plus two. Worldwide, unrest decreased. I'm actually less excited about that, as I probably should be, because that's helping Alm too. But whatever. Alright. So now you'll see that Thunderstrike has been redded out for most of these guys, because most of them are now not carrying any gems anymore, which is sad. So the question really is, we're going to have to deal with this army first, I think.
You probably got to shore up two fronts. I'm talking the marsh and probably the forest to the south.
Well, the thing with the marsh is that I don't actually give a shit about it. If they take the marsh, I am fine with that. Like, you can see, it's worth 10 gold a turn. This is probably the single shittiest province I own. It's got a lot of resources, but that really doesn't help when you only make 10 gold a turn, and when there's nothing interesting to recruit here.
Okay.
I should probably check and see if I can recruit anybody interesting from these forts. Lion Tribe Witch Doctor? They're a little interesting. This might be worth building a lab just to get a couple of nature and... you're not terribly likely to get the fire paths. Never mind. Probably not worth it. Ooh. Oh. Yeah, no, these guys are useless. They're actually straight up worse than my Fearbolt Druids. Wolf Tribe Shamans. Not great. I didn't really expect to find anything phenomenal here, but... Okay, and it looks like this is a Horse Tribe province. Each province has kind of an invisible thing that tells you what kind of units inhabit it. Sometimes you get really lucky and you get cool wizards and or like lizard men guys. Most of the time you just get regular commanders and occasionally priests, like not that province. This one. This is pretty normal. You get militia, archers, infantry, you know, chumps. But none of those guys are terribly good, so we're not really interested in them. What we might do is cut down on producing the medians just so we can have our prophet build what am I, crazy? We want a fort there, not a temple. So we're gonna have this oligarch fellow build us just palisades is probably fine. Changed my mind on that one, I guess. Alright. Just so we can have Devlin back up to the front. Okay. Urkus and Arion are going to go back into safer territory because this river is about to be a war zone. Okay, so there doesn't seem to be a whole lot of stuff lying in this province, although with Ulm, you never know because half their army is invisible on the map. So.
Shrug.
I'm just going to move my scouts around, just kind of try and keep them a little harder to pin down. Now, here's the question. Do we gear up for Thunderstrikey Doom, or do we gear up for something a little more modest? I think under the circumstances, our armies are good enough that we don't really need to gear up for Thunder Strikes immediately. However, what we are going to do is we're basically just going to downgrade from Thunder Strike to this spell called Lightning Bolt. Oh, gotta go, guys. Too late here in my time zone. Gotta work tomorrow. I'll catch up on YouTube. Cheers. Cheers, Owlbear. We'll see you, hopefully, on one of our other streams.
Oh, yeah. Next time, I'm just going to throw in a plug halfway through. We are streaming on Tuesday night starting next week. So Tuesday nights at 7 p.m. So hope to see you then.
Let's see. We're going to boop, 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 boop. We're going to... Yeah, let's just take all the druids along. I mean, this is not going to be a game that runs... There's only two factions in this game, and we're already starting a war with the other one, so... This is not going to be a game where long-term research wins it. This is going to be one of those where you hit them hard and fast.
Right.
Alright. So, we've now scripted all our units to cast Lightning Bolt. Lightning Bolt is basically Thunderstrike Light. It has a slightly smaller range, but still really good. It has a little more precision, does a lot less damage... But that's okay. Because it only costs 10 fatigue, so we can basically throw that crap every turn. It's, So we're going to send these guys down to Dubros. Because I'm not too worried about the bridge being attacked. I'm actually going to throw a couple... That's actually really terrible. I'm not going to bother. Alright, so... Dubros is probably the best province that's currently under threat. So that's the one I want to reinforce right now. If Rotmarsh eats it, I don't really care too much. If Manasseh eats it, I don't really think they will. I don't really care too much. Dubros is the only one of these provinces I really care about losing that is exposed to a large army. So I'm going to move my guys to Dubros, and I'll just crank up the province defense here as much as I can. Maybe even... Actually, I'm already down pretty low on... production here. Let me just bring it to these guys and just funnel a little... Oops, wrong province. Funnel a little more province defense into here. 11 is probably enough to... These are really crappy troops, so I'm not too worried about it.
You calling that a deterrence, or...?
It's less a deterrence and more a... I actually kind of expect this to be able to stop this.
Got it.
You can see most of the province defenders here have shields. And these guys are archers, whereas these guys are snakes who don't have armor, and guys with bows.
Weird that he chose cold, and yet he has serpent groups.
The computer's not very smart. Ooh, hey, we got a follow. Thanks, Owlbear. We hope to see you again soon. We have, those guys... I think that's actually everything. We should be getting Storm next turn.
Nice.
So let me allocate a couple of points for our next research goal, which is actually going to be in Conjuration. Now, this is not actually so we can summon anything, but Conjuration at level 2 has a spell called Summon Storm Power. Summon Storm Power is a spell that any air mage can cast that raises his air magic level by 1.
Ah, okay.
So by doing this, we will no longer need... to feed gems into our wizards to have them thunderstriking.
Nice, okay.
The only catch is that storm power can only be cast during a storm, which is the reason we are currently about to finish this.
Oh, alright, here we go.
The basic setup is going to be our Fomorian King spends 2 air gems to cast storm. He needs an extra one because he's too low a level to cast it normally.
Right.
But that 2 air gems basically allows every wizard on the field to throw thunder strikes for the entire battle. So, totally worth it. It'll take the cost of the battle from like the, I don't know, 20 some that the last battle should probably have cost us to 2.
Wow. That's impressive.
Yep. The savings!
Yeah, that's true. I guess this is a game of savings. You try to get the best bang for the buck.
I kind of find that it's about getting the capability first, then it's about then you worry about efficiency.
Got it. Okay. That makes sense.
Okay. So I think we're good here. I'm just going to end turn, and we'll see if we get horribly murdered. Boop. We did not get horribly murdered. I'm shocked by how few events there are this game. I'm actually a little disappointed. All right, so we have level 5 evocation. We will probably not need to go higher than this for a long, long time. We have conjuration. Now, conjuration is a... Okay, we've already explained conjuration. But we only actually need about 150 research points total to get it to level 2. And we've already done 39 of them.
Sure.
So we are actually going to cap this at only 111 points. And the rest we are going to invest in alteration. The reason for that is that at this point we are kind of done with our Thunderstrike core. Mm-hmm. So we're going to start building... We're going to immediately start moving on to the next best thing.
Right.
The next best thing are our Fomorian kings.
Okay.
And the thing that makes kings so notoriously deadly in this game is that they can be made into very good thugs. A thug is a Dominions term for a unit that is can be geared up to kill arbitrarily huge numbers of weak troops.
All right, so he becomes pretty much a field clearer, if you will?
The idea is that basically, if you have a province that the enemy has left inhabited only by weak troops, you can move one thug into that province and he will single-handedly murder everyone in it.
Wow. Wow. I could just see something like that coming in and going, "Sup, noobs."
Now, the reason why this works... Now, in order to do this, we need a couple of things.
It's like Darth Vader against, like, regular troops.
And that's actually exactly what it's going to look like.
That's kind of awesome.
In order to do that, we're going to have to research construction up to level 4, because there are some critical magic items that we need there.
Right.
But before we even do that, the next most important thing is this spell here, Mistform. Mistform, I think, is probably one of the most badass combatant buffs in this game. It basically turns your body into mist, which only solidifies when you want to hurt something. So anybody who attacks you hits nothing but cloud. So any physical hit that hits you is reduced to 1 damage.
Wow. That's so good.
It's incredibly good. The only things that break mist form is if you get hit for more than 25 points of damage, which is very hard to do, or if you get hit by a magic weapon, which is why you only send thugs against shitty troops.
Right, okay.
Anybody who's elite, you risk running into somebody with like a sword of sharpness or something.
Or something that we're carrying right now.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Damn murder blade of doom.
That murder blade of doom is pretty much designed for killing thugs.
Right. And gods.
And gods, yeah, that too. So, our next plan is we're going to research this spell so our kings can go mist form and mix it up in melee.
All right.
Yeah. So I think that's actually all we got to do here. Man, I'm so bummed by how low the things are getting. I really should have given this guy more gems. Oh well, that's fine. What I will do is I will give the gems to Devlin and just have him join up. I'll give him like 10. That should be plenty for a while. All right. So we're going to move Devlin into Manas. We don't care about Rotmarsh. This is kind of our buffer state. We are going to make an attack into Dershid. And the reason I want to do that is because not only are there a whole bunch of dudes here in desperate need of some lightning-y doom, but you can see this white building here on the map. I will zoom in so you can get a real good look at it. That is a temple. You can see that we have temples in Utenshire and Fomoria. Ulm has temples in Ulm and in Dershid. We really don't want Ulm to be winning the Dominion War here. And it looks like his wizard, for some reason, bought a ridiculous amount of Dominion, which is stupid expensive on Archmages, but whatever. So we are basically going to walk into this province, because if we take it, we burn that temple to the ground, and that's 400 gold up from his treasury that he will never see again.
That would be devastating. That actually might turn the tide. If there is a tide. I feel like you're controlling things a lot better than what the computer should be allowing you to control.
The computer is not very good at this game. I kind of wish it was better, honestly, for purposes of this game, but it's not. It's just a thing we have to deal with. I'm actually going to swap these guys around just because it bothers me that the formations look like that. Okay. That'll do. So, we have this dude. His first action is going to be to throw out some storms. Where is it? Here it is. Why is it red for you? You have gems. You should be... Oh, I know why it's red for you.
Because the research points haven't been met yet? Is that why?
No, it's because he doesn't have enough paths. He should be able to cast it, though. Just, you know, in terms of having the gems for it. Whatever. We're gonna... Oh, he doesn't actually have summon storm power yet. So maybe we're gonna hold off on the ridiculous gem murder this go around. We'll just stick to lightning bolt. It'll probably be fine. So this will probably be a lot less one-sided than our last fight. Yeah, you'll do. Okay. We are gonna call that a day. Actually, I'm gonna move these slingers up to here and move these guys up to here. It's honestly a better idea anyway, just because now they won't be accidentally buffed by the druids. Alright. I feel like there should be more going on in these turns, but we're just not getting any luck messages, which is sad, because I took all those luck scales for nothing. Alright. So, let's end turn here. Alright, this is better. So we have all the conjuration we need now. We're not going to research anymore for a long time. We're going to throw all this crap into alteration, because we need probably another solid 227 research points for it. And... Urkus has searched Jelania Gora for magic sites, but none was found. That's sad. Eren found two, though. That's awesome. Grove of Fertility, which is a nature gem every turn. And a Lilium Veil, which is a death gem every turn. We're going to need both of those. This is actually really good. Because there's a magic item in nature that I want to be able to forge that I may need to empower one of these guys to do. I'll explain empowering in a minute. Okay, so you can see we have now basically declared war on Ulm by invading one of his provinces. The AI is smart enough to know that this basically means that it is on, so it is now going to attack me pretty much immediately. I fully expect it to march this army into Rotmarsh nigh instantly. Now, these guys are going to go here. This guy's going to go here. Yeah, that's actually really good. Because it's going to take him a little while to get through here. Because this... He can only move one province next turn, and he's in a swamp, so he'll only be able to move one province again next turn. So I think I can actually have my guys back to Utenshire before he can do anything after taking this province here.
You're not expecting him to move north?
He might, but this is a much juicier target. Okay. It's got a fort on it. This province is worth a little more money, but honestly not very much.
Do you want to beef up any defenses to give him some hard time?
This guy? No, this guy's going to walk right over anything I could buy.
Okay.
So
it's not advantageous to even, like, thin out his, or make it, I don't know, cost him something.
Let me put it this way. He's got 140 units on this province that I can see. Probably right. More that I can't. If I were to spend my entire treasury on guys, I could get a lot of guys, but not anywhere near 140. And his guys are much better than mine.
Wow. Okay.
And that's dumping 1,200 gold into province defense.
Which would be probably silly.
There are much better things I could spend 1,200 gold on.
Right.
For example, I could take this jerk from Fomoria, move him here. This jerk from Fomoria, move him here. All right. I can start recruiting kings, because we're going to need those in a second. I can start recruiting druids, because we're going to need those in a second. I can bring my unit production back up to spec. You can see this is a lot. This makes me a lot happier.
Oh, yeah.
Then.
Yeah, you're playing the long game, which is a... Good. Yep.
I find in general it's just better to have units that can move than it is to have units that can't. So we're set for that. We're set for this. You guys found your sites. Let's move you guys into Ctesiphon and see if we can find anything there. Okay. I fully expect to lose this province instantly, by the way. I was more aiming for the troops he had there than anything else. Did I have some guys retreat? Inexcusable. I did have some guys retreat. Alright, well.
Did you see that battle?
Oh yeah, that's true. Let's load up that battle and look at it. Oh, my Nemedian champion died. That's a little sad. He probably took... Yeah, look at it. You see how it reported 80? There was actually 193. I was kind of expecting something like that.
Wow.
Let's watch that. So, there's my army. It probably looks very familiar. That's his.
Oh, jeez.
Actually,
make note of his formation.
Well, this army's dead, so he probably won't be using it again. But
formations are...
Yeah.
...are interesting.
They are. This actually is particularly interesting because... Line formation, because of the way the scattering works, is particularly designed to piss off mages like my Thunderstrikers. Because, like, if you have one square of scatter here, you have pretty much... You're just as likely to hit nothing as you are to hit anything actually important.
Right.
So, this is interesting to know, I guess. So, let's see. Things of interest. We have long dead. These are basically skeletons. We have... Lizard warriors, who are basically just unarmored chumps with tridents. We're not too worried about them. We have ogres, who are basically big, dumb sacks of hit points that do a lot of damage, but they don't hit very often. We have... Oh, this is one of his leaders. Hernagliscus the Shaman. Earth, you can see he's earth and death. He's a priest. His research is really bad. Okay. None of this is too terribly worrisome. We have forest warriors who are just basically lumberjacks. We have axe warriors who are like forest warriors except without any of the wood skill. These guys. I think these are one of Ulm's best units. Steel maidens?
Yeah, you pointed out last time we played.
Yes, I did. Their whole... goal in life basically is to murder the shit out of giants.
Wow.
They dual wield short swords, which do a ton of damage in and of themselves because they're fairly strong. And they get two attacks with it a round, which means that if you buff them, you could be potentially looking at like six attacks coming in from every single square that they're in.
Wow.
Hopefully he won't buff them too bad, but I don't intend for him to meet giants anyway. This is Ulm's generic commander, the warrior chief. He's not really that interesting, except that he's stealthy. What else is interesting here? Clockwork soldiers. These are, weird units. They're really good, but they have this exhaustion 15 thing, which means that every turn they get 15 fatigue until they basically wind down and stop working.
The mechanical?
Yep, they are mechanical units. They're like golems, basically. It takes a wizard to lead them. They're mindless. They don't run away. They're resistant to a lot of stuff, which means they probably won't take any damage from my lightning bolts. But I'm not too worried, because once they wind down, you know, you just walk over them and kill them. We have anything else interesting here? These are crappy independent light infantry. They're not very good. Steel warriors. These are Ulm's most expensive unit. They're basically Conan. You will notice that there are probably like 20 of these guys. And every one of them is like Conan.
Wow.
They are also sacred, which means they can be blessed. I don't know if Ulm is planning to actually do that, but if he does, we may actually get a chance to look at their what their bless is. Oh, these actually aren't steel warriors. It looks like he's only got this one guy. You can see he's got a great sword here. The others have just hammers and shit. Now there's another steel warrior here. It looks like they're just kind of scattered around, but he does have a couple of them. And then he's got these, which are his archers. They're not really anything to speak of, except that they can actually hold their own in melee, which is weird for archers. This guy, I think, is the commander of his force. You can see he's a level 2 Earth Mage. You can actually do shit with 2 levels in Earth Mages, so I'm a little worried about this. But we'll see. I did jump him fairly fast, so he may not have had time to do a lot of research yet. That's kind of what I'm hoping for. Alright, so let's see how this goes. Okay, so he cast Legions of Steel and Stoneskin. Legions of Steel basically makes his buffs the armor on his troops. Stoneskin, which I think was this guy? No. It was this other dude, wherever he is. I can't actually find him. I'm sure someone on YouTube will be like, hey, dummy, he's right there, but I can't find him in this mess. There he is. Okay. That's what Stoneskin does. That guy was not wearing armor. Now he has a basic protection of 21. Heavy infantry, for comparison, has like a 12.
Wow.
Okay, so all our guys are loading up the Thunderstrike batteries. Or the Lightning Bolt batteries in this case. One of his wizards is animating zombies, which is fine. You can see the Thunderstrikes working their magic. Except Lightning Bolts, I guess, so less magic.
Man, those ogres are strong.
They are. They don't hit a lot, and my you'll see my Fear Bulk have defense skill of 15. His ogres have attack skill of 10.
Wow.
So my guys are very dodgy, which will help. But yeah, you can see the lightning isn't doing nearly as much as the thunder strikes do.
It's not a one-sided battle here.
No, it's not.
It's pretty even. They got a lot of special units, though.
Oh, yeah, these guys are the Horned Serpents you saw before. They basically, they're not that interesting. They're basically big armored snakes with poison.
Miserable.
Yep. Not too worried about them, though.
Kill them with lightning.
Like that?
Yeah, like that.
The thing about his big dumb troops, like the lizards and the ogres and the snakes, they actually have to hit me in order to kill them.
Oh, yeah.
And I did lose a lot of Fear Bulg in this battle, but they don't get hit easy. They definitely, every one of mine took down like 3 of his with them.
Right. What is that?
That was a magma spell.
Oh, wow.
You can see it sets shit on fire and kills guys. Yeah. That's kind of what I was... The magma spells are kind of what I'm afraid of coming from all...
You got this deep troops over here at the top. Just kind of...
I'm not too happy about that, actually, because if they make it through to this line, I'm in some real trouble. But we'll see. I suspect they're just going to divert straight to here, but we'll see how they're set to go. Very clearly, though, I need to bring my troops more... spread them out wider. So that's something to note for future battles.
Well, that's why it's good to look at the after-action report and see the battle at the same time.
Exactly. You can see some of his troops are already running. Ogres. Actually, that ogre has phenomenal morale.
He's done.
But he's running anyway.
Yeah.
These lizards are gone.
The trouble is, like, it's not a waste of time to do this because you learn so much from a battle.
Yep. Yeah, this is a little nerve-wracking. We'll see how it goes. Oh, you can see my wizards have gone off script now, so they're just casting random shit. You can see they... I think everybody's blessed now. What's my bless? Earth, astral, and nature. Okay. That's fine. Not good nature either. Now, the question is, did he bless himself? He did not. He has not blessed himself yet. Where's his other...
His line's about to break.
We can only hope. Because this is trouble. Where is that other wizard? That stupid jerk. Here, okay, here he is. Dang it, neither one of them blessed himself. I really want them to bless themselves so I can, like, take a guess at some of the things their god does. Oh, wait, somebody just cast... Oh, that was one of my guys. Never mind. Never mind. Not actually useful.
So as they weed out the troops in the front row, it looks like you're, the guys from behind... Oh, that's devastating.
Yeah. Yeah, the defense skill of my Firbolg doesn't actually do shit against
magma.
Against, well, any ranged attack.
Yeah.
Any ranged attack. Arrows just as, hit them just as easily. You need shields and armor to defend against that stuff, and magma penetrates shields and armor. Okay, yeah, they stopped and they came in around the flanks of my line, which is actually okay. Because my line is thick enough that the flanks can turn and face them.
It looks like the lightning's getting slung again.
Yeah, a little bit. These guys, they're starting to fatigue out at this point, you can see. They all have over 100 fatigue now. Yeah. So my wizards are pretty much out of it at this point. It's down to the foot soldiers. I expect his wizards are probably not doing much better. Yeah, fatigue 109, fatigue 98. Not gonna be a whole lot more spells thrown in this fight.
Looks like their line's breaking again. It looks like the morale's dropping.
Yeah, it looks like their crappy light infantry broke. I'm not shocked by that. These guys are the real threat.
I think as soon as those ogres go down, though, that's it. Those clockwork soldiers are done, aren't they?
The clockwork soldiers are probably, yeah, fatigue 150. They're not moving anymore. That's the reason I never summon them. They're great in short fights, terrible in long ones. The archers broke. That's pretty much it. Once they leave the field, this is done. This is done. Because once 75% of the total hit points of your army flees, everyone flees.
Right.
Oops, I think I just thunderbolted my own troops there. That's depressing. That dude is never making it out in time. He's done.
Yeah. He disappeared. Well, you routed them, that's for sure.
Oh, this poor guy. You can see that some of these guys incur battle wounds. If you take a heavy enough hit, then you can get permanently maimed. So, like, this guy has now lost both his eyes.
Oh, my God. But here's another good question. These people that fled, where did they go? Did they go back to a province?
Good question. Where they go is basically they split up. Basically, because they're no longer they're in disarray,
right?
And they will flee in roughly even numbers to all friendly provinces connected to this one.
Got it.
If there are no friendly provinces, then it's assumed that my patrolling forces hunt them down and kill them all.
Okay, that's good to know. So if there are friendly provinces nearby, they will go to them. If not, then they are hunted down and murdered.
This may come up later, depending. Once we bring our kings into the thick of things. Oh, right. We just set it to hire that guy. Okay. All right. I'm losing my mind.
That's all right. That battle was kind of fun to watch.
Yep. Oh, hey. A death match in the arena. The participants must leave now to get there in time. The winner will receive a powerful magic artifact. Each god can only send one champion to the competition. If you remember last week, one of our visitors was talking about the arena events.
Yeah.
This is the
arena
event.
Oh, cool.
Basically, I can pick one guy from my side, Somebody presumably fairly strong.
The guy with the unbelievable weapon and shield?
Let's say... And I can send him into the arena to fight the basically the best of who the other guy sends. Normally, I find this is not really worth doing, because if there's enough players in the game, you have like a... You know, if there's 15 players, you have a 14 out of 15 chance of getting your unit killed.
Right.
However, since there's only one other player, it's going to be me against something that Ulm has. And I'm pretty sure Ulm doesn't have anything that can match that.
Did you give him the special weapons of amazingness?
Oh, yes, I did.
Yes, send that guy.
So.
How does it work?
For the time being, what we're going to do is just kind of fill out the lines a little. Just one second. Okay. That will have to do, I guess. Oops.
And what are you doing? Just moving troops around?
Yeah, I'm basically just trying to fix it so that I don't get flanked by any more jerks.
Yeah, smart.
Okay, now, we are going to delete this guy's script and try and script him for something a little more sensible for a...
One-on-one?
One-on-one. Unfortunately, most of what I have here is scripted to just massacre the crap out of...
Hordes and hordes of people.
Yeah. So I'm going to use that Holy Avenger spell, which should be useful. Maybe also... let's say...
What is Hand of Death?
It's actually not as good as it sounds.
Oh. Don't give something an awesome name like that.
The problem with it is it's a melee spell that hits one guy.
But you're up against one guy.
While that is true, my Heartfinder sword basically does this job 8,000 times better.
All right.
It's basically a death spell that hits one guy who's standing right next to you.
Okay.
But since that really doesn't matter here. Ulm usually prefers swords, so piercing resistance isn't going to help me. This might help.
So does your warrior have safe passage through provinces to get to the arena?
It's weird. He actually doesn't have to go anywhere. He just pretty much stays where he is for a turn.
Oh.
Which does concern me a little bit, actually, because he is kind of exposed here. So if Ulm attacks this turn, it might not actually be worth fighting in the arena right now. Yeah, I think I might actually just pass.
It's not advantageous. For the whole big picture of it.
Like, I could send one of these guys, and maybe that would be worth it, but... He's
going to give him the magical weapons, or are you not even going to bother?
Well, that's the problem. I don't really have any good gear to give him. I think I'm just going to skip out on the arena.
Alright.
As entertaining as it is... Actually, no. I'm not going to skip out on the arena. I'm going to send somebody disposable. And the reason I'm going to do that is because... Who can I afford to lose? I probably won't need this scout for much longer. Oh, I guess I can't with him. That would have been nice.
The thing is a champion, so it has to be a named character?
It has to be a commander. I have a bunch of Earth Druids. I'll send an Earth Druid. He is almost certainly going to lose, but that's all right. Because the real goal here is to kind of get a look at the other guy's unit and maybe possibly get a shot at killing him.
Or maiming him.
This might actually be worth it. Earth Grip basically paralyzes a dude because the Earth reaches up and seizes his leg. Yeah.
All right.
So we'll try an Earth Grip early on just to try and keep him away from me.
And then shoot him with lightning a bunch of times and see what happens?
That's the idea, anyway.
Okay.
We'll see how that goes. Yeah, I'm not gonna bother doing anything with them right now. Okay. So I think that's this turn.
How do the statistics look after your battles?
You can very clearly see that we had a fight in terms of army size.
Yeah.
It hurt him a lot more than it hurt me, but he has a lot more troops to begin with, so...
Very serious difference there. As far as Dominion goes...
Yeah, he's winning the Dominion fight. I don't like that.
I thought you burned down one of his temples, even
Well,
still.
I did, but, you know, he must just have a pretender with a ridiculously high Dominion score. Because that factors into it, too. We're closing the research gap, which is good. Our gem income is still better than his, but he's catching up. Our income is way better than his. Well, a little better than his. Ooh, he built another fort. That's not good. All right. Well, we gotta clearly get our crap in gear. He probably built that fort here.
Right.
Okay. Let's do this. Alteration research completed. We need 59 more RP in this, and then we can get started on construction. There we go. Okay. Construction gets us a couple of things. It gets us this, which is nice. It is a spell called Summon Corpse Construct, which basically lets us make Frankensteins. They work kind of like zombies, except they're lightning resistant. Which is great for us for a number of reasons.
Right.
We probably won't actually build that many. What I really want is this.
Greater magic items.
Yep. There, just so you can see the whole list of what you can buy in the construction school.
Sure.
You'll notice that Legions of Steel spell that Alm was casting is here. So he's been forging magic items himself.
Okay.
Yeah, it's going to be alteration, construction, then enchantment, I think. For reasons that you'll see. Oh, hey. Good luck event. A sage has appeared. He searches for a place called the Library of Time. Tired of his long and fruitless quest, he now seeks employment in your service. Zorfion the Sage has joined. So you can see he now is hanging out in this province.
Oh, looks and... like they took the marsh, rot marsh.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. That's actually a really tiny army. Okay. Yeah, that's fine. We're going to deal with this guy first, though. So he's looking for a magic site, which is probably either going to be here or in one of the surrounding provinces. You Sure. will notice that he is an astral mage, which Okay. is awesome because it's a type of wizardry I don't normally have access to. He's also a phenomenal researcher.
Good.
Like, he gets 17 points a turn just by himself. But in the meanwhile, I'm gonna send him out and search for magic sites in case he can turn up that library and I can hire a whole bunch of sages.
Well, that sounds amazing.
Ugh, sorry, my nose is killing me today. Ugh, we have Mel. Who's Mel? Oh, he actually won. Hold on, this we gotta see.
Excuse me?
That druid actually won the arena deathmatch.
Deathmatch result.
Research and alter. Okay, battle in Epernia. I guess I'm not surprised we won that. I'm shocked that he let us kill one of his shamans so easily, but... Alright. I'll take it. I'm not even gonna look at that one. Rotmarsh. Yeah, he just didn't attack me with anything. Alright. So, just a lot of little tiny skirmishes. I guess he brought his army back to try and fight me.
You can't watch the one-on-one fight, sadly.
You should be able to, actually. I don't know. Oh, he didn't send anybody.
Oh. So, he won by forfeit.
He won by forfeit.
That's great. What's the magical item we received?
The golden sandals, which... It's cursed, which basically means I can never unequip it.
Mm-hmm.
But... It gives me map move +1, +5 defense skill. It allows me to command 25 extra troops. It gives me luck. It gives me quickness.
That's awesome.
They're great items. they're just, it's annoying that you can't remove them. Like, you can see his leadership is 60 now.
He's capped out. You could give that guy an army.
I could. I'm not sure if I will, but I could. Okay. Right, that's all set up. We have... You know what we should do? We should start getting a couple more commanders to haul guys around. Yeah, right. That's fine. We are gonna need to get these guys started back up again. Alright. So, the other thing that we can do now is I can take this jerk. Why do you not have gems? Who has gems? Somebody should have gems. Aw, you're kidding me. Okay, for some reason, nobody has gems. Oh, right, I gave them to the prophet. That's why. Okay. I guess I'll just give them all to this guy, and then... There we go. So now we can re-script to be awesome. We are going to...
And we're not going to hit the number two like you saved it. This is going to be completely different.
This is going to be completely different. Yep. Because that's important. Then we're going to throw up a storm power. There. Just to ease things up a little. Thunderstrike. Actually, is there anything more important you could be doing than thunderstriking? Let's see. Mist? No, we definitely don't want that. That limits the precision of all the missiles that are thrown in the fight, which includes javelins and lightning bolts.
Well, don't throw that. That would be bad for you.
Yeah, okay. No, I think I like him just the way he is.
You're not going to have aim or anything like that?
I would kind of like to have aim, but I think I'd rather see him... Actually, yeah, we'll do aim. All right, so... We'll start with this, only at the second round, instead of aim, we do summon storm power. Okay, now we're in business. Now you can see there's a huge army there.
Wow!
220. How many guys do I even have right now?
That's a good question. Not enough.
I have about 150 spearmen. I have... Actually, I might be able to take that army. I think I probably could.
But here's the problem. If you lose, you're boned.
The question is, do I think I'm going to lose?
Well, I don't know. You tell me. Are you going to tighten up your squad? Yeah, I guess you are.
Yeah. No, I'm not that crazy. Yeah, that looks pretty good. Okay. I am also going to draw my prophet back because I really just don't want him...
Losing your prophet would suck.
Yeah, that would be terrible.
Does he have any magical weapons to buff up his things?
Well, he's going to throw out a divine blessing, because one of the things that will do is it'll make my druids recover from fatigue faster, okay. Which might make it so they can get a couple more thunderstrikes out.
That might turn the tide right there.
We are going to... Beyond that, probably smiting is the most useful thing he can do.
Okay.
Actually, maybe some Sermons of Courage would be good. We'll see. I'm not really sure how effective that'll be, but we'll try.
Well,
Sermon of Courage increases the morale.
Certainly your troops will be running away, so...
We'll see. I mean, my troops are pretty elite in the first place. Like, 11 morale is pretty friggin' solid. And these guys have 13.
Yeah.
So I'm not too worried about that. Actually, you know what I might do? I might put, like, as many... Numidians as I can in the center group, just because that's the group that's going to be taking the most fire.
And they're your best troops.
Yep. They are definitely my elites. Okay. So we want to stack the deck on that middle group as much as possible.
Sure.
All right. 55 in the middle, 50 on the sides. It looks good. So I'm going to take this opportunity to try and even the odds as far as army size goes.
You're going to take his capital. Or, I guess not.
If he didn't have these other two forts, I would try.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to spam some defense here, which I think should make... might be able to stop those 10 units. His 10 units are pretty elite, but this is like 20 guys. I think the odds are pretty decent.
You just make sure.
Yeah, never hurts. Because I know there's actually only 10 units here. Because
this is going to be a bigger battle than the other battle.
Yeah. Okay. And this is going to be a more epic one, hopefully. You will also notice, by the way, that I have now... started all my melee guys further back.
I have a question.
Yes.
What if he reinforces that city and...
Ah, okay.
Did you put that guy... Oh, right.
I was just trying to make sure that dude in the center wasn't somebody who was important.
Oh. So what if he reinforces his position from Lama and the other one from the south?
I think that's relatively unlikely. He might get some of these guys from Lama, but I'll be real with you. These guys from Lama are terrible.
Okay.
I think if he did get those guys, they might actually hurt him more than help him.
Okay.
If only because they'd get in the way of his good troops who are all in this army.
All right.
What concerns me is that there might be more than 220 units in this army.
That's plausible.
But we'll see how that goes. So, like I said, though, we're going to be outnumbered a lot in this game, and the idea is that we have a strong enough strategy to make it not matter.
You Fomorians are outnumbered 10-1.
Oh, son of a bitch. I forgot I was going to build a temple here, and I can't... This might be worth it, at least.
Is that to increase your dominion?
No, I'm trying to make sure I have enough money to afford a lab, but I'm not sure I'm going to... Oh, wait, yes, I will. Okay. Actually, the Nemedians are really, honestly, less important than the Fear Bulg, if I'm being real with you. Because the Fear Bulg, I can buy them in greater numbers, and they're the backbone of my army.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can't win a fight without enough infantry. All right, we're gonna put you back on research duty for now, but we'll have more uses for you later, maybe. Okay, good enough. Wait, who's the Fear Bulk scout? Oh, you. All right, that's fine. Actually, I want him up here because I want to see more details about this fort. So,
hold on to your butts.
Yep. This, one way or the other, this should be an interesting turn. He might actually just completely move this army somewhere else, and I won't even hit it, but we'll see. Okay. So he did attack Fast Deer. Most of his... a lot of his troops died. Not most of them, but...
He must have retreated.
No, he actually won.
Oh.
His five Steel Maidens and his Shaman was enough to beat that province defense, even after everybody else died. Okay. So we now have Mistform. Mistform being awesome. Now we just need a ton of points dumped in a construction, and we'll have our first thugs online. Search Ctesiphon for magic sites. Yeah, that's depressing. Okay. So there's no magic sites that anybody found here. We're going to move them on to Onramark. Actually, we're going to move them into Lilithor. Because throne provinces tend to have more magic sites than other provinces do. Let's see. Battle in Fastir, we saw that. Battle in Mitanni. Glorious.
Holy smokes.
They lost 121 units. We lost 27.
We kicked their ass. Holy smokes.
Let's see. I imagine this went pretty much the way I hoped it was going to. But we'll see. Yeah, he's throwing out legions of steel. Okay, so now that the storm is up, you can see this thing here.
Right.
If I click on that, that'll tell me what the
natural storm.
Yep. So flying units now can't fly.
Yeah.
Shooting units have trouble shooting, and anything that uses fire magic incurs extra fatigue. So you can see here's his army. It's pretty much more giant mobs of the same troops we've been seeing.
So his magma throwers and stuff are having a hard time?
Yep.
Oh, that's great.
This is one of his faction's big wizards, this antlered shaman guy. He's actually also on the high score list, so he has buffed up defense skill.
Tell me we murdered him.
I think he might actually have gotten away. He's got these two random-ass knights here. These are actually really good for early age cavalry. Mm-hmm. But there's only two of them, and I can't imagine they accomplished very much. We have barbarians. Alright. Yeah, he's actually got a lot of really crappy units in here, mixed in with his really awesome faction.
So his army was basically made of just a bunch of grunts.
His army is... Like, he's got about two-thirds actual good units, and just the other third is just these horrible, useless idiots. Alright. Like these guys. These guys are actually good. The forest warriors, the archers.
Let's play this massacre out. I want to see how these guys went down.
Alright, let me zoom out so you can get the overall picture.
So I expect to see a lot of lightning murder.
It won't start until the third round, but yes. You are going to see tons. Alright, you can see they're all summoning storm power now. That little lightning bolt that hits them is pumping up their air. See, you can see they're now 3-1 instead of 2-1.
Oh, gotcha, okay. So they're not going to get fatigued as much.
The Prophet blessed them all, so they have a little bit of extra fatigue stuff going down.
Oh man, those cavalry guys on the side. I wonder if that horse is going to run right in the backfield.
I'm not sure what the heck is... Why no one stopped him. Alright, well, whatever. You can see the thunder working its magic. There's just a lot of troops to plow through is the problem.
Right. That cavalry guy disappeared. He just
Well, one off. Of them died. This guy... Oh no, he didn't die. He ran past. What is
Oh.
He got a special lightning bolt just for him. Oh, some of my fear bolt got hit with that one. It's a hazard of a profession.
He came right up to that shaman. He's just like, no.
I said, yeah. Yeah, that was pretty good.
This guy down here is just...
I'm not sure what his deal is. He's probably going to get... If he gets too close, he'll probably just get another lightning bolt to the face. Because none of these... I don't think any of these guys died. So... He did a ton of damage, though, I think. I don't know. Maybe not. All right. Fair dues. He must have missed. Cavalry do tons of damage on the first hit
right.
with their lances.
What's all that flying over?
That's his archer, and I think his shaman are throwing some really crappy battle magic.
Well, I mean, what I'm looking at here is if it wasn't for the lightning, it would really be a real problem.
If it wasn't for the lightning, I would probably be boned. But the lightning is honestly doing a lot of the killing for me. These guys are kind of here to hold the line while it does its magic.
Right. The serpents are terrible.
Yeah, they don't really accomplish very much, I find. They have more protection than I would have thought. Aw, this poor guy.
Lost an arm.
Yep, and he's got, like, PTSD now. I always feel bad when I run into a unit like that. This guy's, you know, weakened, battle fright. This is what happens when you have a guy who's been in too many battles. I should probably, like, pull some of them back. I kind of wish there was a way to disband units in this game.
What, like this?
Be like, you know, you serve with honor, go ahead.
Become a regular citizen.
Yep, just because otherwise the only way to get rid of units that you don't want to pay the upkeep on anymore is to march them into an enemy territory and have them killed. And I always feel a little bad about that. Okay, yeah, you can see a lot of their guys are starting to retreat now. So this is going to be one of those, let's chase the enemies while we flee off the map and murder the stragglers.
Right.
You know, huge.
Yeah, I don't see any more lightning bolts flying, so they probably hit their cap.
Oh yeah. Thunderbolt is a spell that utterly wrecks your fatigue levels.
It's so expensive, though.
But it's so good.
You use it to its best ability at the beginning of the battle, and then you hope that it was enough your troops to kill the rest of them.
Frankly, that's exactly how it works.
It's scary. It's like you roll the dice.
I mean, if you get enough... I'm going to actually probably bring a couple more Thunderbolters to the field in a turn or two. But
I would have called that probably your best, more or less finest battle. Because it really meant...
Dershin. Oh, yeah, that's fine. I was kind of expecting this to happen. Oh, this guy actually retreated. Okay. He's wounded enough that I don't really know that I want him.
Yeah, lost an arm.
The chest wound, honestly, is what ruins him. The chest wound gives you an extra 5 points of encumbrance, and that's just a mess that nobody wants to deal with.
You're removing his command?
Yep. We're going to send these guys out to deal with this. Okay, Zorfion didn't find anything there. I want him out of harm's way, just in case those jerks try and try anything in Jelania Goria. This place already has some province defense. This place has a castle, so it doesn't need it. Basically, if you have a castle, all of your units in that province are safe.
Okay.
Until the enemy can reduce its defenses by a certain number of points.
Got it.
This is not a particularly good castle, but it's enough that, you know, how 6 units are not going to be able to hurt it.
Right.
Whoa. I should have finished reading the messages, apparently.
What happened?
Well... My fort went up in the throne province.
Nice.
These troops are... I have too many troops in this province, so they're starting to get hungry, which is no good.
Right.
Just means I have to run back and nail somebody with them. And, this happened.
Suddenly...
You remember I was talking about... hero units last week.
Yeah.
This is the best hero unit Fomoria has.
What?
Out of the 4 that can possibly show up for this event, he is probably the single best one.
Really? So he's a hero.
He is one of my Fomorian kings on steroids, amped up with a cybernetic arm.
Give that man the
Actually, I'm sorry, a cybernetic eye, because I'll show you what he does.
Give that man the Sword of Amazingness and the Shield of Harming. Whatever.
Honestly, the Sword of Amazingness would reduce how many people he kills around.
That's awesome.
His deal is basically Balor is the High King of all of Fomoria. He's the ruler of the entire nation. You can see, he starts out basically as powerful a priest as my prophet.
That's awesome.
He's a level 4 necromancer.
Oh my god.
A level 3 air mage. He's so terrifying that anybody within 9 squares of them has to make fear checks every turn or run away.
So he's basically like your nation's predator. He just like grabs his crown, puts it on his head, and runs into battle, and everybody on the field just goes, "I'm gonna die!"
Not just that. When all the other Fomorians got cursed, he got cursed twice.
So he's doubly cursed.
His curse is that his eye kills anything that looks into it.
Oh my god.
He gets to make this attack 10 times per round in every battle.
Oh my god. That guy is awesome.
It hits,
and terrifying.
It hits 5 squares at a time.
So he's got the Eye of Sauron in his skull, and he's just looking at people and killing them.
Basically, yes.
This guy's absolutely impossible to kill. He's amazing.
Yep. Yep, he is, this guy is one of the reasons why I take luck with Fomoria.
Get this man an army and put him on the field of battle.
Working on it. Alright. So, we need more construction research. Once this gets up to level 4, we'll be in really good shape. But, in the meanwhile, I want to keep him here temporarily. Actually, no, I don't want to keep him here temporarily. I want to send him up to Utenshire, where I'm hiring all those troops. These guys. I am going to stop recruiting kings, because I've got enough at this point. And I'm going to drop back down to druids. Yep. Yes, I did.
You've won the lottery, sir. Congratulations.
That was about the best possible thing that could have happened. We are gonna... Actually, I would rather have a druid up here than a bunch of researchers everywhere. All right. So that's going to be our game plan for this turn. Oh, oops. How much time we got left?
We got roughly 10 minutes or so.
All right. Wow, that flew pretty quick, actually. All right. We're going to send this guy forward to escort some troops. Okay, so this is a relatively new fort. It doesn't have a lot of troops in it, but it's got a throne. So we're going to need to take this fort down in order to win the game.
Right.
So, I'm not prepared to deal with that right now. But it'll be a priority for later.
You got a starving thing happening over there, so you gotta move it, guys.
Well, we just did. This is a forest province. It should have more supplies in it. These guys should be pretty much a pushover. These are made up of mostly shitty independent troops. Yeah, I'd rather wreck these guys. There's more of them, and they're better. Bring a commander back there just so I can have some loose troop ferries. And he's still high. I bet it's his archmage that's hiring those clockwork soldiers.
Yeah.
Oh, he's summoning wolves now, too. The wolves are not particularly worrisome. But, alright. We're going to end turn here, I guess.
We should look at the stats.
If you like.
Some pretty good.
Just give you a nice summary. Okay, so he took some provinces back, which is okay.
Right.
You know, we're trying to... we're even on forts again. He's bringing up the income gap, but that's because he's raiding me with that tiny little army that's about to get obliterated.
Right.
Gem income.
You guys are almost neck and neck on the increase for sure.
Yeah, at least we're holding our own on Dominion. I don't really care too much about it at this point.
Army size.
This combined with this is what I like to see. This is big pain for him, not much that I care about for me.
Right. But we still have little gains right now. Like, as far as our army size goes, we're knocking him down, but it looks like he can recover them just as fast and then lose them again.
Yep. What I really need at this point is to get enough mages to the front that I can massacre his troops faster than he can recruit them.
Okay. I mean, it looks like that's what you're attempting to do.
Well, I mean, it's the goal. We'll see.
Okay.
Okay, research and construction completed. We need this to get to level 4, but we can get started on a few things at level 2. A battle in Fosdir. Okay, we basically stomped that army. We didn't kill the leader who retreated with... Oh, poop. One of his steel maidens here. This army fell back to Dubros. We are going to have these guys fall right back into this castle because that is ugly.
What is that? Oh, yeah, that looks pretty serious. 140 units at least.
Yep. All right.
Well, it looks like what you're doing now is a regrouping maneuver. So I guess once you come here and defeat these clowns, you're going to have to move them back to Urdenshire and basically make sure you have your men recruiting.
Yep. As many as possible.
Because you're going to need fresh guys. You're going to need fresh guys because you're going to be hurting. And where's your champion, the new guy that came into the play?
Oh, Balor?
Yeah.
I moved him up here. Actually, I'm going to have him spend a turn searching because
he's got the eye of crazy.
Yeah. If anybody can find a site here, it'll be him. Actually, I'll have everybody search there because they've all actually got different paths that are useful here.
All right.
Okay. Man, that is a distressingly huge army. I need some area attack shit stat.
Okay. Well, you got a plan. That's good.
I have a plan. I'm not sure. I mean, what would be phenomenal is if I could get maybe like this might be worth it.
Holy smokes. Fatigue cost is
out the roof though, yeah. You're really supposed to cast this kind of shit out of a communion, but our faction doesn't have access to those, so we'll see how that goes. Or this. If I could get Shimmering Fields out somehow, that would be incredible. Like angels would sing. I might have to start looking into some death stuff just to see if I can arrange for some murder to happen. All right. We're going to research.
He's probably going to move that army out of the marsh because there's probably not a lot of resources there to feed that army.
No, I imagine a lot of them are... He's going to have to. I am not even going to... Actually, I'm going to buy 1 point in Fast Deer because you always buy 1 point. Why is there a unit there? I don't even know. Just in the interest of salvaging as many as can be salvaged. Bah, whatever. Okay. Alright, I think then that we are good to go. That guy, I'm just looking to see if there's anything useful I can do to him. This might be worth doing.
What's that?
Okay, so you guys can also cast spells out of combat. If you click and give him the cast ritual spell order, you get this menu here. And these are all the rituals that I've researched so far that you can cast. Mm-hmm. This is the Frankenstein one I was talking about.
Sure.
This one lets me summon, evil spirits. This one lets me summon an evil spirit who acts like a scout. This one lets me summon, you know, giant killer dogs. But in this case, I could spend some air gems to basically slam his capital with a hurricane.
That'll be worth it. What does that do for him? Does it cut down his income so he can't build an army?
It, among other things, it pumps the unrest way up, which will be great.
Right.
It kills part of the population. So, indirectly, it hits his income.
Okay.
So we're going to try that. Once I have more... Oh, yeah. I see why I was doing that. Once I have some more guys capable of casting it, maybe I'll throw out a few more. But I pretty much need my kings for that. Alright. We're going to, I think, call that one a day. Oh, wait. There are some events we didn't read. Okay, this was another glorious success.
Mm-hmm.
No wizards in this fight. It was just a straight-up...
skirmish.
Straight-up skirmish. This is his guys. There's actually not that many of them. Oh, this is Dubros. There's actually not that many of them here. So I expect this to be just a curb stomp. However, During the nighttime, green lights can be seen dancing in the skies. Mages have reported a worldwide surge of magic. This actually doesn't even help me a little bit, because we maxed out our magic scales at the beginning of the game. You can't get more than three dots.
Got it. Okay.
So it's a little bad for us in that respect, but we'll deal.
Okay, roll the dice.
All right.
Oh, man.
Two more turns. So we have our hurricane went off. I can't necessarily see what it does, but...
Nothing was found.
Aw, that's sad. All right. You guys are going to go up to Anremark. I've got better things for you to do than to sit around whining about magic sites.
You're basically going to chase this army right through these provinces.
Yeah, I kind of hope that it will stay still and let me murder it, but I don't really expect it to. Alright, we're gonna throw these guys down on commanders. Oops, you're not a commander. You're a commander. Where's my other commander? There we go. Just because they can hold more troops. And here's the fun part. Now, we could just keep chasing this jerk forever.
Mm-hmm.
But I would really like these troops to deal with this.
Sure.
So, what we're gonna do is we're going to get these two commanders along with, let's say, six relatively uninjured Fomorians. We're going to ride them into Remesia.
Okay.
Because what's going to happen is this guy is totally going to take this province.
Right.
So what'll happen is my guys will get to move before the attack happens.
Okay.
So he'll take this province only to find 60 Firbolg and four druids hurling lightning at him.
Good.
I'm going to... If you use Y, you'll bring up the tactics screen on the units that are moving into the province you have selected.
Okay.
Which is incredibly useful.
Yeah, that is.
Okay. So now these guys don't have a Stormcaster with them, so they're just going to straight up murder some dudes with lightning, with Lightning Bolt. But that's okay. I really expect the Fear Bulk to do most of the work in this battle. Less than ideal, but it'll have to do. Alright, and we'll leave the druids back behind them. Okay, that should be sufficient. Commanders back behind that, because they are more valuable than the troops, less valuable than the druids. Sad fact of life. So you jerks are researching. You're moving, you're researching. Oops, I meant to move you there. You're going to move there. All right.
This will be your last
turn. Yeah, I think this is going to be the last turn for us.
Yep.
Until part three, when hopefully we get our asses kicked a little bit less. These both worry me a lot. I was really hoping this river would not freeze, but then it did. You can see, too, his dominion starting to encroach on my side of the river.
Right.
Which means that I need more temples. Alright. Let's try another hurricane. Maybe I can hurt his income. Let's see, actually. You can see the hurricane hurt him.
Yeah.
So we're going to do some more of that and see if it helps. This is basically the amount of income his capital has. So we've still got lots of room to make him hurt.
Yeah.
All right. I think that this is where we are going to leave it. Next turn, we should be able to start churning out our thugs, which I wish we could afford more of. What I might do is I might actually send a Fomorian down through here and try and conquer some underwater provinces for extra income. You can see that this is worth like 77 by itself.
Yeah.
All right. That's where we're going to leave it for tonight, I think. You can see it's going less well than I had hoped, but we're doing okay on the fronts that matter. So, we'll see how this turns out.
Okay. So, I guess we'll just save it right there before we hit the end turn mark, so that next time when you guys join us, we'll have a humongous battle and prepare for even a larger...
Well, I don't know about humongous. This is not going to be...
All right, well...
This is not going to be that crazy.
The trap will be sprung in the next turn, so that we get rid of the remaining troops they have in our lower provinces here, and then we'll take care of, we'll take care of Faster with all those other guys. But unfortunately, that's all the time we have for today. I hope you guys really enjoyed yourselves, and I hope you guys are enjoying the Dominions 4 tutorial as we put out this very detailed and very, I think, comprehensive learning experience. For me it is anyway. And Rob, I want to thank you, for showing.
Yeah, all of no us. Worries. Actually, it's good. I was anticipating that Ulm would kind of roll over and die, but it looks like he's actually going to put up a bit of a fight. So
this is great.
We'll see. If we're really lucky, I might even get my ass kicked.
Well, I hope it doesn't come to that. That would be really hilarious.
I'd laugh.
It would be hilarious. But unfortunately, guys, it's all the time we have for tonight. My name is Chris from Cartridge Blast Gamers, and this is Rob, and this is Dominions 4. I hope you guys are enjoying it. Please like and subscribe. Share the videos as you see fit. We're on YouTube at Cartridge Blast Gamers, and we'll catch you next time.